This is a fantastic opportunity to have a look at where the Arrowheads went next.
Yep.
Hi, it's Todd here for Arrows vs. Armour 3, and I am with Will Sherman.
Good to have you back here.
In Will Sherman's Forge. We have come here for the very specific reason of watching Will forge the Arrowheads that we used in Arrows vs. Armour 1 and 2, but obviously more recently in Arrows vs. Armour 3, because they're quite different. And by watching him forge them, talking to him, getting an understanding of what it's all about, we'll understand the cost implications, how fast they were to make, the reasons that one would be used against another, why one superseded another. In Arrows vs. Armour 1 and 2, we looked at the Type 9, the short bodkin. But in Arrows vs. Armour 3, we moved on our dates from the 1415 of Arrows vs. Armour 1 and 2 to 1450. Now, 1450, in the run-up to that, for quite a while, they'd been using the Type 16s, the bladed and barbed type heads. But around about 1450, they started transitioning, moving on. So by 1461, Taunton, they've transitioned all the way to the Type 21s. Also bladed, also barbed, also made of hardened steel, but made in a different kind of way. Our work on Arrows vs. Armour 1 and 2 meant that we had a really quite a good understanding of how these Type 9 heads worked. But by this point, we hadn't done any work on the Type 16s, the small bladed and barbed ones.
Yep.
And so that became the focus of the Arrows vs. Armour 3 film. I'm going to put the Type 21 head aside for the moment. We'll come back to that later. But looking at the Type 9s and the Type 16s, obviously they look a bit different, but there are principal fundamental differences between them. One of them is size. One of them is weight. One of them is the materials they're made from, and the other is the way the sockets are formed. So, Will, let's just chat through the four principal differences between these two heads.
All right. So we found with the first two films, we were using these Type 9 bodkins, whatever you want
which
to call them.
Which are quite long.
They're very long, yeah. And the length of them means you're looking at a whole bunch of weak spots. You've got the neck here, which can bend and break. You've got the shaft area, which can bend once you've applied leverage to it.
And you get the leverage because we'll just get our lovely helmet here. Because as the arrow strikes, it's striking on an angle here.
Yeah, the arrow is still moving forward.
Yeah, and so it's bending. And because of the length of it, you get a very long bend, a long lever, and you cause a fracture at the neck or at the socket, usually just behind the head.
So that's been solved later on by shortening the entire head and you end up with these.
Yeah, so those leverage problems are gone.
They're all gone. You also solve the issue with the tip bending by making the soft iron tip, which is never going to hold up against a steel plate, out of steel.
Yeah. Because again, it's important to note that there is loads of archaeological evidence that the Type 16s, the barbed heads, were steel-tipped and steel-bladed.
Yeah.
And there is almost no evidence to say that these short bodkins were ever made of steel.
What's really interesting is that these are often found with an iron socket and steel edges that haven't been hardened. So they're still adding the steel on for whatever that reason is, ductility or hardness or whatever.
Well, it's still tougher.
But we're not finding many. They've either been made of steel, I think there's one that was made of steel, or any that have been case hardened.
Yeah.
So it's an assumption that they did it because they could, but we know they were doing this because we found them and they've been tested. Whereas these are an iron socket and they've been steeled.
Yeah.
They've been hardened at the point with steel. So that's the material difference. By welding on these barbs, you also weld them, in the ones that I've looked at, over the socket seam.
Right.
And we found that when these impacted with the armour, the socket would blow open and allow the arrow to drive forward, whether they're glued or not. By welding that shut, you can see I've welded it over the seam itself.
Yes.
That does two things. One, it adds the barbs themselves, but it also welds shut the join. So now that can't open.
Any energy that is used to force that socket open is not going forward into the target.
Yeah, you're not losing it with the opening of it or the arrow driving forward.
No. But the other aspect that needs to be mentioned about the improved materials, the hard steel, is that a glancing blow, anything that's not onto a flat plate with an iron bodkin, will tend to gouge, tend to create a skid off, but it will not bite. So the energy of the arrow is dissipated, it's sent somewhere else wherever the arrow goes.
Yep.
Again and again, we noted with these hardened Type 16s.
Yeah, at crazy angles, they're going to bite, and it's a very different... You can feel it in your own hand, you can feel it.
It bites, it stays, and all of the energy is transferred into the helmet.
Yeah.
And you saw that repeatedly with the fact that the arrows aren't strewn all over the field, they're just dropping at the target's feet, because all of the energy was given up.
Yep.
And that was really notably different.
We weren't expecting that, were we? No. So the final point that we have to make is weight of the arrowhead. Now, an arrow, obviously, as an object, it needs to have a certain amount of weight to work efficiently. And for a long time, we've been thinking that these are the standard arrowheads, but they're really heavy. Mm. They are more like crossbow quarrels. That's about 25, 30 grams, and that's getting into too heavy, really. whereas these are about 10.
Yeah.
And they go down to 6, even 5. The Westminster Abbey head is 3.5 grams,
right,
we estimate.
What this means in a practical sense is that these barbed heads, these Type 16s, will allow an arrow to travel further because the arrow is lighter. So it has a distinct range of advantages over the old Type 9.
Yep.
So effectively, it bites harder,
yep,
it gives up more of its energy, it travels further,
yep,
it travels faster, which is very often useful for deep penetration.
Yep.
And the question remains, how long do they take to make?
Right.
Because that's all well and good, saying that we have all these advantages, all these reasons that we want to move onto a head like this. But if it's unaffordable, would they have done it? Well, they probably wouldn't.
So you've got a dead basic Type 9 bodkin here made in iron. That takes me about 5 minutes.
Okay, so one person doing the job, well-paid guy, skilled, yep, got it.
Yeah, it's definitely a one-person job, that one. This one is a two-person job. You've got an iron socket and you've got steel barbs over the top of it.
Yeah.
That takes me about 7 minutes.
Okay. But of those 7 minutes, then, you've got the unskilled part, which, yep, is a couple of minutes. So that's kind of like the apprentice boy's job.
I wouldn't pay him for that, yeah. Right. All day long, he's rattling out barbs for me. I'm then forging just the socket training and welding them up together.
Okay.
Yeah.
It is somebody, but it's not really paid work. So you've got what's left in there is what? So about
the same,
five minutes.
Yeah.
So it's about 5 minutes of making the cone, forge welding the barbs on.
Yep.
Okay. So although they look quite different, and this does take longer, the Type 16 takes longer, but you have an element of unpaid or extremely low-paid labour in there.
Yep.
Whereas that is all high-paid labour.
Just one person working away, yeah.
So comparatively, it's reasonable to assume that they will be a similar kind of cost.
Yep, I think so, yeah.
All right. Well, that's one thing. The next thing...
let's go make one.
Yeah.
All right.
Right, there, lovely.
What was that, 5 minutes?
5 minutes 10, Will.
Right.
5 minutes 10, one finished Type 9 arrowhead.
Nearly finished.
And there you are. A little file and that'll be good to go to the lines, won't,
yep,
it? Type 9, 5 minutes 10.
For one person, yeah.
For one person, so of skilled labour.
Yeah.
So show us Type 16.
All right, cool.
Lovely work. Let's have a look at it.
All right.
So that was 735, Will.
Oh, okay. Yep.
So if we take away the couple of minutes of the apprentice boy doing the barbs on there before you forge welded them in, then this one, the Type 16, has taken 25 seconds longer.
Fine. And shorter, it's harder, it's stronger, it's lighter.
So I don't know, whatever that is, 5-6% longer.
Yeah.
But loads of benefits with that.
Yep.
Now the next stage is very obviously off to the grindstone, back to the apprentice boys again, because they both need to get sharpened up. They are beautiful.
There we go, yep. So you Type 16, Type 9.
Fabulous. So let's recap where we're up to at the moment. So the Type 16, the bladed and barbed head, takes very marginally longer to make than the more old-fashioned, softer iron.
Yep.
It gives you the benefits of a lower weight.
Yep.
Goes further, goes faster.
It's harder, much, much harder.
Much harder, stronger.
Yep.
So there are lots of reasons that you would want to use it.
Yep.
All fantastic benefits and reasons to move on from the old Type 9. So these, by 1450, absolutely everywhere.
Yep.
But things change again. So the subject of Arrows versus Armour 3 really was looking at new armour, but it was also looking at new arrowheads. But by 1461 in Towton, we know that they've moved on. So what were the finds there?
So in the bottom corner of the field where they found arrowheads, they found over 300 of one type. And it's what we're calling Type 21 now, based on the London Museum catalogue.
So not these anymore. So just in that 11 years, it's been superseded.
Yeah, probably an overlap. Yeah. Always an overlap with technology. But definitely by 1460 and again, 1471, Tewkesbury, Battle of Tewkesbury, they're built the same way. But they're not welded together, they're brazed together.
That is a whole different thing. And although it is not the subject of Arrows versus Armour 3, this is a fantastic opportunity to have a look at where the arrowheads went next.
Yep.
So, Will, Type 21, please.
All right.
Back to the grindstone to sharpen them up.
Here is our finished, ground up, hardened, quenched Type 21 braze.
Fantastic. And I can tell you that the skilled element of this build was 4 minutes, 45 seconds.
Oh, great. Even faster than an iron bodkin then.
So, iron bodkin came in at about 5 minutes.
Yep.
Type 16, 525
right.
for the skilled element of that.
Yep.
4 minutes, 45 for the skilled element of that.
Right.
Although at the time of Arrows versus Armour 3, 1450, these Type 21s were not around. They're just on the horizon.
Yeah.
So you can see why they transitioned away from the old Type 9s.
Yep.
Type 16s, they're hard, they're light, they hit harder.
Yep.
But the Type 21B does all of that for less cost and faster.
Yep.
And less skilled labour, because labour shortages, labour problems are forever an issue. And that helps to solve that too.
Yeah, why wouldn't you use it? That's the choice, isn't it?
Yeah.
Really.
And we haven't done extensive tests on these yet, because that's not what Arrows versus Armour 3 was.
Nope.
Might be in the future. But at the moment, what we can say is that we're pretty sure these would behave in a pretty similar way.
Yeah, the frontal edge is the same. You've got hardened steel working in the same way.
So you've got the same benefits at a lower cost. That has got to be why. You see them at Towton, you see them at Tewkesbury, and you see them really through the last 100 years of the age of the military longbow.
Yep, there's paintings from 1475 showing exactly that shape. Yep. You know, they were using all the way through until gunpowder made the bow defunct.
So, Will, thank you very much for showing us the process, talking us through.
Always welcome.
But this is just one film in the Arrows versus Armour 3 series. So we have multiple others, but there is the main film which you cannot miss, which is 7 heavy warbow archers shooting at an armoured soldier from 1450 with
Type 16 barbed steeled heads.
And it is fascinating. See you again.
Cheers, guys.